I would like to thank all of you for attending this session. So today I'm going to talk about serverless computing and how it combined with AI development. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Huang Jian. I am the architect for Huawei in charge of cloud computing. Actually, three years ago, when Huawei first dabbles in cloud and container technologies, I began to take on the architect works and also technology development. And first of all, let's look at what is serverless computing. Actually, this is a quote in Google I/O. What is serverless? Well, actually, it means a developer, you don't have to think about those servers when you're doing the developing in the future. You focus on the code, on your business, rather than the servers. So only focus on the code, only focus on your business. That would be the future, ideal future. And cognitive actually also focus on serverless computing because they are focusing on OpenStack. They are doing the VM. And right now, after Cognitive, we are focusing on a VP. When the customer is deploying their APP, they don't have to care about the serverless. That will be the future for our computing. And so this is the serverless Kubernetes. So in the future, a lot of cloud service, a lot of industries will based on Kubernetes or based on cloud. So they want to choose what kind of technology should be the infrastructure for serverless service. So when it comes to Kubernetes, they have function service, they have other functions, and they have, now the definition is more broad. For example, the backend service, you could use KPI to call up cloud service, or you could have a middleware service, which is also serverless. And as you can see here, this is designed by myself. This is a service ecosystems based on Kubernetes. And it would centered Kubernetes, centered on serverless computing. This is a service platform. And there's a lot of very hot top applications, for example, Connective. Knative is a very good platform for you to have an application on Kubernetes. It will support you. And also, it will have scalings. And if it is very elastic. And also Kubernetes, Knative also provides you with other services to help you to transfer your service. And also have doc film and other machine learning scripts. All of those can be deployed on the cloud platform. So you don't have to care about how much resources they occupied. And also you have traditional function service, for example, Kubelis or Fission. These are the function service focused on Kubernetes. And also Ref. Ref is also focused on Kubernetes. So it is a application, it is not just a function. We also have Kyoto Ref. These are also based on Kubernetes. So apart from function service, we have batch service. So for example, HPC, high performance service, and also in Kubernetes service, you have other incubating service that can help you with batch service. And in AI service, we have Kubeflow. So Kubeflow is a very hot topic in this market, and a lot of people search after this. And also when it comes to big data service, Huawei is also doing this kind of big data service, for example, Spark, and also you have Flink. Flink have a Kubernetes deployed solutions, and also Spark. So these are also managed by Kubernetes. And also Spark is based on GPMSs. So when it comes to serverless middleware servers, you have Witness or TIKV, they are database. When it comes to message serverless middleware service, you have cloud events and NAS, and also cloud events. So these are the standardization. And so when it comes to Knative, it has already realized the standardizations of the industries. It has its own architect. You can also, it is open source, you can also use those Knative architects. When it comes to storage of the serverless middleware servers, you have cells to help you to storage and to combine storage with computing. So Rook can help you with that. So before Kubernetes, you have middlewares, you have, and all of these have already formed an ecosystem. So when it comes to cloud in the future, so is it possible to have Kubernetes plus Knative? Now we are buying nodes and deploy it on the platforms. But in the future, is it possible for us to use Amazon, use Huawei platforms, using Kubernetes API to solve all the issues? That will be a probable solution. So we are not sure yet, but I believe that when it comes to Kubernetes, it will help you with new API and new interfaces. So based on these ideals, Huawei think about whether we require a serverless Kubernetes platform. And last year, we are trying to deploy this. We're trying to have a community, an ecosystem. So we come up with a CCI, which is a Cloud Container Incident Service. It is a serverless service based on Kubernetes. It is a cloud container service. It provides you with more than 95% API compatible, except host patch, etc. And it is a Kubernetes service supported by IPVS. As you can see, this is the CCI architect. You can see here we have a CCI console, CCI API servers on the second layers, and CCI federations. And you can see that CCI can take on all the different clusters. And when the clients, the end users, don't know whether their API is running on some particular platforms, they don't know that. But we have also a lot of physical hosts. And on each physical host, we will use container technologies. We use kata and runway technologies. Because kata containers, they are based on the traditional Docker technologies. They are a mutual cores. And that technologies can help you with the multi-tenant requirements. So this is a tenant isolation solutions. So CCI can help us with a very flat architect. So it helps us with the ICAST technologies to manage those physical servers. And on these physical servers, we can use Kubernetes. And we provide our end users with Kubernetes API. And when it comes to MDDR and host pass, for example, host pass, we cannot expose host pass to these containers. Because it is a security related issues. So most of the API is the same, is the same with the traditional API deployment. In the past, we were thinking about whether to use VM, whether we trying to use serverless. But after serious considerations, we know that Kubernetes would be a very basic infrastructure for the future cloud computing. So we are trying to create this very flat architect for our end users. And this is a foundational layer kubelighters. You can see there's a kubelighters in charge of CRI, flex volumes, and CNI. And when it comes to Kubernetes, it is a computing technologies. But when you're trying to manage the storage, it is a CNI interface. The CNI interface will connect with a public cloud technologies. The CNI will connect with Huawei Cloud VPC networks. So this is the same with the VM networks. And when it comes to storage, we are using the FastWarner. This is a Huawei Container Storage Manager. We manage the storage. This is also fast storage and object storage. So you can see here, when it comes to CCI of Huawei, it is based on Kubernetes technologies and combine all the different cloud computing, creating a very flat ecosystem. It is a container clouding, cloud computing technologies. So using the CCI platform, what is the advantage of that? Let's look at the next step. This is the photo of our CCI portal. So if you're using our Huawei CCI portal, the end users only have to use the Kubernetes deployment. They could only deploy these kind of applications. You can create VM space, namespace. So we have our own resource pools. You can have a particular customer-made, tailor-made namespace to help you with that. And when it comes to different cloud and and the nodes, it is not exposed. So what is the advantage of the CCI portal? The first thing is that you don't have to care about building Kubernetes clusters and nodes. So in the future, you could only use Kubernetes API. You don't have to care about the underlying nodes. You could just use it.
Kubernetes is good to focus on the So the customers we encountered with, especially during jobs like gene sequencing, and they are willing to use the services because when you are running your tasks, you need to start your job, you need to pay. Otherwise, you do not need to bear the cost. And for clients from the medicine industry, in the past, they used Kubernetes clusters. But to save costs, maybe they install like thousands of clusters, but in the end, after running all the calculations, he deleted all the clusters. So every time he repeated the installation and deletion, so they are willing to use this kind of services platform so they could hand in their tasks, and all the resources are aligned by the platforms. That we think is the future basic and for the platforms. And also because today's topic is how to boost the AI industry, I would like to briefly introduce the platform regarding AI from Huawei. And that's the platform at the bottom for Huawei Cloud. All the AI services, including training, are running on Kubernetes. All are containerized, and they have used the traditional services, and also from the upper layer, we can support all those common open source framework for deep learning. And also we have our own framework for deep learning, and we also constructed this modern arts from terminal to terminal, how to upload, manage the model and training. It's a terminal to terminal platform. And also we have image recognition and all the advanced APIs and common solutions. It's a whole package of AI solutions over Kubernetes. So next, I would like to talk about what we do for AI on the basis of Kubernetes. We have four aspects. First is AI computing. As you all aware that for AI computing, we concerned about the resources for the computing. The CPU is relatively not so powerful. We need the support Nvidia GPU and also launched by Huawei, the Ascend chip. And for now, we have already supported Ascend 3.1.0. And for network, for now we mentioned we've connected VPI network so that customers, users could gather data from their from all those networks. And also we've been working on the agreement network in order to broaden the download capacities for downloading all those data. And we also support all this agreement. For this part, because it's very interesting in the field of training, like the connection to the image, the broadband is very wide and about 28 G. So traditionally, the calculation power is not enough. So for storage, we've connect all those traditional methods. Maybe some of the users, they need their local storage. We also can support in this way. For all those disks, we have divided into several parts to limit in IOTS. And also in scheduling, we also focus on the bench. This is also appeared in the committee that I will introduce later. For all those training tasks, we would like to have received the resource scheduling at the same time, and sometimes we do not have enough resources because the computing is happening at the same time. For some tasks, they receive the resources, but for others, it is a waste of cost. So we need all the tasks at the same time, scheduling in parallel. And also, we support high-volume workload placements to improve the speed of scheduling. So next, I will mainly focus on computing and network to introduce what we have done. First is AI computing, it's Nvidia GPU platform. So for our committee, we have already supported the standard method using the normal container. For example, like one GPU or several GPU to a container, we already support this method. And also for the same container we use, we can also support the VFIO to connect the GPU to the container. For traditional method, the drivers are located on the main server. And also the update and maintenance of the services. If the user uses GPU, we will automatically put the driver into the container. If they use the same imagine, it is the same for all those containers. They do not need to maintain or operate the driver themselves. Also, we have a certain version to get connected to the containers and services we use. And that is what we use in the training process, because CPU, that's mainly in training. When we using the GPU, we have another problem is that we need to use the GPU for several containers. Normally, of P4 GPU, we need for more than three containers. Actually, its capacity is relatively high. For deduction, it do not need such high capacities. We can share that, so we support that we share the one equipment to several containers. Technology about VM is not available for this kind of sharing, but for this one it is okay. But at the same time, we've already improved the algorithm, the development manager and NVIDIA for this computing. We are using all the GPU resources consumption on the nodes to report to the API server, and our scheduling will based on the resources to extend. And the scheduler will, basing all the consumptions, to determine which is the specific node to conduct the process of scheduling. Why is that? Because we have some scattered tasks. For some GPU, their consumption is relatively low. So how to handle this kind of scheduling? Because normally it can only support the full digits, but it cannot conduct such precise scheduling. So we extend the ability. Because we have the 0.2 or 0.3 requirements, we also conduct something different from the port of NVIDIA. We will monitor the consumption and adding to get a total number to see whether you actually exceed the number of 0.2. If it is, we have several strategies to get rid of the container because there aren't enough resources. And if for the safe care. If it exceeds the main request for the resources, it will be deleted. If all the resources are not scheduling, we allow this kind of excessive consumption to a certain degree. If you use a P4 line, it cannot be operated in this way, but you need to use the software provided by Nvidia. We can realize this kind of container sharing scheduling. But in terms of kata, we can also achieve this result. The GPU technology is relatively mature. It's more convenient for Nvidia grid to control the capacity of calculation for the GPUs. But the cost is very high. So in production, you cannot use this kind of technology for the license. It's too expensive. It's the twice of the cost of GPU. It's just not very cost effective. So now we are waiting for Nvidia T4, which will support PSRV. So for this kind of technology, it can divide one GPU into several ones. Okay for us to conduct our tasks, and later will be supported by Nvidia. So at that time, you could divide one CPU to several containers to use to achieve sharing. And for several scenarios, you may have this kind of sharing. And also, Huawei launched two new chips this year. One is the CN310, with a relatively low computing capacity. And this one, with a higher computing power, but will be officially be used in the second quarter next year. So for CCI, for now, we have in Huawei Cloud, we are running for Serverless. This is on our physical machine. We have this PCI cards, the SAN cards. We have four ports here, can be used for a container. So we have 32 containers that can be run on this chip. So we calculated in this way. In the past, if a P4 GPU cannot be shared, it can only use to run four containers. For our GPU, we have two CPUs and 80 cores. If all divided, you need 10 CPU. Actually, it's quite a waste of resources. But for 32, it's 2 cores and 4G. It's very suitable for conducting such kind of tasks. So further, we will improve our technology in the future to virtualize all those tasks and support more containers, but for now, it's already enough for the demand. And we just talked about the chips. So here, let's take a look at the AI training model with the introduction of network and scheduling. This is the TensorFlow parameter server. It will include several servers and several workers. But now we also have some reduced model, because for PS model, we gather all the resources but have a high pressure on the network. We have some also reduced model to pass on to the next GPU. So this way, it's improved in terms of a network. So we have two demands here. First is required for the capacity of the network, and also the PS and worker and GPU we hope we can schedule them at the same time to have enough resources now to wait for one point and to scheduling them one by one, and that is a waste of money. So in terms of a network, we have the InfiniBand support. For example, like CCI, for this platform, we can support, like you can see all those containers here. For InfiniBand, it can divide one physical network card to several virtual ones to support that we can run several containers here. And also one thing is very important, that because we have several tenants in this environment, we hope, like in the orange and green tenants, to have a network isolation. We cannot, because we have the Mellanox. You can set up the partition key and isolate all the resources. Once the setup is done, the network is isolated between different tenants. So in this way, on this basis, we achieved a 100G network connection and to improve our AI training acceleration.
So now,
architect, so to make sure the GAN schedule can be achieved, so that in the future Huawei can combine these different projects to fully leverage all of the features. So later I will introduce what is possible. So this is possible based on Cambridge, some Cambridge big names, software. So this is a word for
centralized dispatch.
And when it comes to Kubernetes, AI frameworks can also be run on our platforms. So we hope that we can achieve this in the future. So the core business for us is providing Kubernetes API, dispatch time. So when there's a parallel dispatch by our overseas customers, we can achieve that. We can help other Promote AI, so what they are doing is based on tensorflow, they have a However, all of those are based on Kubernetes, based on Huawei networks, based on Huawei storage infrastructure. So the training image after their test, they can reach a
0.8 million.
So after their testing, they can reach a training image net 1.2 million database with 128 GPU card within 12 minutes. So, overall speaking, in the future, for AI service for Huawei, I believe it is quite different with the past when they were using the big data and AI with Spark. But I believe in the future, AI will be based on Kubernetes. And now, big data and computing also based on Kubernetes. And I believe that we are building a Kubernetes-based serverless platforms for Huawei. So that is my presentation. Any questions from the floor? We don't support 1.2. So when it comes to 0.8 or 1 or 2 or 3, we don't support 0.8 knots. So whether the question is about whether we can use GPU card across NOS. The question was whether we can use cross GPU cards across NOS. Yes, we can achieve that. Our kata container can achieve this. Now our platforms are providing for our AI teams. And the end users don't have to, it is not exposed to end user. So the audience is not using microphone. So we are also, Huawei also doing the Spark. Our computing teams are doing the Sparks, but that is also still undergoing. And when it comes to Spark, there's a lot of new versions that support a lot of different platforms, and we're trying to support. So now we are developing it, and it will be seeing the market in the future. The audience is asking question without a microphone, the interpreter cannot hear. Okay, let's talk about the mirror. So we are not doing the mirror or the mapping, but our AI service, there is a tool to help us. If you have all the TensorFlow script, then you have a mirror automatically on this platform. The audience is not using microphone. So what you're asking is on the superstructures, but I am doing the container technologies within the base layer. In the superstructure, it is about AI service. There are data collecting because Model Arts, the Model Arts platform will have the solutions you're asking. The audience is not using microphone. How about the training failures? So if the training is failed, then you need to do retrainings. But we have remote control. So if your bandwidth is wide enough, then you don't need to download anything. And the OBS interface can also support. And so the storage systems can be modified. So otherwise, if you have training failures, then you need to retrain again. It seems there's a lot of questions from the floor. So I want to ask you, because in our own company, we developed a similar systems, but the challenge we have is that when you have a deep learning doc image, when you upload a deep learning doc image, it's very big. For example, it could reach 20 gigabytes. So if you deploy it and then the training fails, then we try to allot it. So the batch job and the dispatch systems need to go on another platform. You need to have another mapping, which means it takes another 30 minutes. Yeah.
The storage, but mainly it's about the mirror. Our current technology is to accelerate P2P and improve the environment of the bandwidth. But it's also traditional P2P image. The local is not suitable for. It's all better to use Kubernetes for the mirroring locally to accelerate the storage, but it's not for serverless. Because you are not sure what kind of services will be operated on this node. But for single tenant, you could stabilize it and to accelerate it. To load all the mirror. Okay, so. It's not a vGPU. Because you need to rely on virtual technology. How you realize this kind of tasks? For CPU, it's C loop, via CPU share and code tab. And for GPU, how to achieve these tasks? Just like I've mentioned, for GPU, it supports one equipment mounted on several ones. And we use monitoring, for example, like taking out the value of this upper layer. And it knows the flow and the containers, and you can calculate how much space is taken. For the computing, it must rely on its framework of Nvidia to support the time sharing at a ratio. But use a V version, but normally we are P4 for deduction, not a V version. So it depends on in the future whether it can support SRV. So now you're just monitoring. If it exceeds, then you need to control the process. Okay, we know that you have a lot of questions. We take one last. My question is that for GPU sharing, use the only criteria is video memory. But if the call is taken, then all the issues that we have, how to handle this kind of a situation. So now we use technology like RAID. Because the cost is also another issue, is relatively high, but for T4 is supported by the hardware for the scheduling of the computing. If you like to support for computing resources, I would like to know metrics, your criteria. For it is divided in terms of a video memory. Actually, this is the limits of the hardware. If a V version, you can control the ability of computing. But for P4, it is not possible. We cannot offer more solutions. So for now it's all related to video memory. For IPS, it's in groups. Okay, that's all for my speech. Thank you. And also, you can contact me for further questions.